Hi, welcome to Cool Ideas. Today we'll study a strange surface named the Klein bottle. You should have already seen this strange bottle folded on itself and called a Klein bottle in tribute to the mathematician Felix Klein, who is the first to have drawn it. You will find many videos on this topic, including those of the Number Field channel with Cliff Stoll, a crazy enthusiast of these pretty German bottles. The neck of the Klein bottle curves and turns downwards. It passes through the wall of the bottle body and, once inside, it widens to merge with the cap. Unlike a regular bottle, a Klein bottle has no edge, but it is not a closed surface, since you can go from the inside to the outside. To fill it with water, you have to go through the nerve and turn it over. A bit tedious, but we're getting there. A fly can walk all over the surface without encountering any obstacle. Like a Möbius ribbon, Klein's surface has only one face. But there is this passage where the neck of the bottle passes through the wall and that requires drilling a hole. But this hole is not real. This is an illusion due to the projection in 3D space. Indeed, this surface is a 4D surface projected into 3D space, and this crossing results from the constraints of the projection. Understanding 4D is not that intuitive, so we'll go progressively. First, we'll stay in 3D and build a simple torus. Second, we'll use the fourth dimension to build a second type of torus, the Clifford torus. And last, we'll twist this torus to build a Klein bottle. In geometry, a torus is a surface that has the shape of a tire. Our American friends say donut, but I'm from Lorraine in France, and in Lorraine, donuts look like this. That's why I prefer to keep tires, which are the same in Lorraine. To build a torus, we start from a long cylinder that we curved around an axis to close it on itself. This operation is very similar to the formation of a ribbon loop. We start from a flat ribbon that we closed on itself. It is the same operation. But let's stay on the ribbon for a moment and look at the dimensions of space that we need. The flat ribbon extends in two dimensions. To form the loop, the length of the ribbon must be bent around the circle. Since the circle is a two-dimensional figure, this must be done in a plane that contains the length of the ribbon. The most often, we use the vertical plane. With this additional plane, the loop of the ribbon is formed in 3D space. But we could also decide to stay in the horizontal plane, and it works very well. We can perfectly close the ribbon on itself. We made a loop without the help of the extra dimension. But there is a price to pay. The edges of the ribbon are not the same length. To close the tape in this way, we must compress the inner edge and expand the outer edge. You can try to close a ribbon in its own plane. This is impossible. You need a third dimension. Closed in the third dimension, we see that the ribbon breathes better. We can freely expand it as much as we want. When it is closed in a plane, if we try to expand it, it will eventually bumping into itself. Our ribbon is cramped. Let us carry out the same analysis with the torus. Now, the starting cylinder is a volume that consumes two dimensions for the section and the third dimension for its length. To close it on itself, we need to choose a plane that passes through its axis. As the figure is symmetrical with respect to this axis, the operation is the same regardless of the plane we choose. It is just the orientation of the torus that changes with the plane we choose. With the flat ribbon, we saw that depending on the plane we choose to close the ribbon on itself, the matter of the ribbon will be deformed or not. With the cylinder, we have only one possibility. In which case are we? To answer, let's choose the horizontal plane. Now, let's observe what happens to the blue horizontal ribbon and the green vertical ribbon contained in the cylinder. By closing the cylinder, the vertical ribbon is closed in 3D, while the horizontal ribbon is closed in 2D only. the green ribbon is at ease, while the blue ribbon is cramped. And indeed, our torus is cramped. If we increase the section of the cylinder, it ends up bumping with itself. A torus necessarily has a large radius, the one of the circle used to close the cylinder on itself, and a small radius, the one of its circular section. The center of the small circle is located on the large circle. The shape of a tire can be generated by moving the small circle along the large circle. The reverse is not possible. The two circles play different roles. One is the guide circle, the other the section circle. You can try with a cylinder of paper. Impossible to bend it and to close it on itself without making ugly folds on the papers. But you can still make French donuts. If we want our torus not to be cramped, we must close the cylinder in a plane that passes through the axis of the cylinder, but that does not contain the blue ribbon, the green ribbon, or any other ribbon inside the cylinder. We need a fourth dimension. Let's start by plunging our cylinder into a 4D space. The three-dimensional visualization of a 4D space generates distortions. The section of our cylinder now appears elliptical, but we must keep in mind that this is still a circle. The length of the cylinder remains straight. We can change the perspective from which we look at the cylinder. It seems to be distorting, but it's just our 4D camera that changes its point of view and presents the cylinder from another angle. The figure obtained is a 3D figure. In our 3D world, we can also observe this figure from other angles by moving our camera, the 3D camera. And we can have fun moving both cameras at the same time. We turn around the sculptor that changes shape. With four dimensions at our disposal, we can use a plan that contains the axis of the cylinder but does not cross the plane of the section. Two dimensions for the plane of the section and two dimensions for the plane of the loop. Despite what the 3D projection of this plan suggests, they are independent. Their intersection line exists only in 3D because of the projection and varies when you move the 4D camera. Let's place our 4D camera to flatten one of the dimensions of the cylinder section. From this 4D perspective, the cylinder seems almost flat. The additional dimension is now vertical. By closing the cylinder on itself, it looks like we have done the operation on a ribbon. But changing the 4D perspective reminds us that it is indeed a cylinder. This torus folded in 4D is called a Clifford torus. It is, in a way, a torus that is completely free, a torus that could be made of paper if it were possible to fold the paper cylinder into the fourth dimension. This torus has two pinches, but this is only due to the projection from 4D to 3D. In 4D space, the torus has no pinch. These two pinches correspond to the two pinches that we see on the image of a ribbon. In 4D, the torus finally breathes. You can freely increase the radius of the cylinder section without any problem. A strange phenomenon then occurs. The pinches of the torus open at the same time as the hole in the center closes and gives rise to the two pinches that reappear. When its size increases, the radius of the section eventually becomes greater than the radius of the loop. But that's not a problem with the 4D version of the torus. The role of the circles that seems to be reversed is just due to the 3D projection. For example, let's form a Clifford torus starting from a cylinder of radius 1/2 and a loop of radius 1. Let's increase the radius size of the section to 2. The pinches open at the same time as the hole closes and gives birth to the two pinches. We can visualize again the formation of the torus from a loop of radius 1 and a section that is no longer 1/2 but 2. But one can just as easily reverse the roles and form the torus from a loop of radius 2 and a section of radius 1. The two circles play symmetrical roles. Each one can be larger than the other. In 4D, each circle acts as a guide and section for the other. It's like the two edges of a rectangle. There is a long edge and a short edge, but they have the same role. Changing the size of the edges just changes the shape of the rectangle. Moreover, by folding the opposite edges together, we obtained a Clifford torus. For fun, let's look again at the formation of Clifford torus, including the moment when the circle of the sections seems to move in its own plane before looping towards the other end. What is the relationship between a Klein bottle and the Clifford torus? First of all, the word bottle itself is a mistake or a joke, I don't know. The Felix Klein used in his paper the word Fläche, which does mean surface in German, but the translator confused with the word Flasche, which means bottle. And since the drawing of Felix Klein was very close to a bottle, this word is still used. So we should say Klein surface rather than Klein bottle. I prefer to say Klein torus, because Klein torus is to the Clifford torus what the Möbius ribbon is to the ribbon. We remember that to form a Möbius ribbon, it must be twisted half a turn before closing the ribbon on itself. Well, to make a Klein torus, we will also twist the cylinder before closing it. Let's observe the twisting of a Möbius ribbon. It is done around the axis of the ribbon. If you naively do the same operation with the cylinder, nothing interesting happens. When you close the cylinder, you still have a Clifford torus. Again, let's use the fourth dimension for the torsion. We will twist the cylinder in the plane containing the horizontal axis perpendicular to the cylinder and the axis of the fourth dimension. The twist gradually flattens the section of the cylinder along the horizontal axis. It's because the horizontal axis rotates in the fourth dimension, which is not perceptible in the current 4D projection. The moment comes when the projection of our cylinder is completely pinched. In reality, the section is still circular. It's just that now its projection is a segment. The cylinder is twisted only of a quarter turn. Let's continue to twist it. The section widens again and the pinch moves to the center of the cylinder. We also notice that the inner face has passed to the outside. When the half turn twist is complete, the pinch is at the center and on each side of the pinch, the inner and outer face are reversed. The pinch may be surprising, but this is what happened with a simple ribbon. If you twist it half a turn, you see a pinch in the middle. And it's the same with our pinch cylinder. Just move the 4D camera to change its appearance. We can even observe the cylinder so as to flatten the vertical dimension that has not moved. And we see appearing a ribbon with a twist of half a turn. This is the twist we have just made. We notice that there is a change of color in the middle of the ribbon. This change does not exist with the 3D Möbius ribbon. But don't forget that this is not a ribbon, but a flattened cylinder, so there is a double layer. We'll discuss that point later. Let's move our 4D camera to give back some volume to our cylinder. Now that it is twisted, we can close the cylinder on itself. The surface we get is a Klein surface, a Klein torus. But this shape does not look like a bottle. This is a torus. We will come back to this point at the end of the video. We immediately notice that, unlike the Clifford torus, the 3D projection of a Klein torus has only one pinch. But this is not surprising, because with a flat ribbon loop, we see two pinches, when we see only one pinch on a Möbius ribbon. Initially, the cylinder has one color for the interior and one for the exterior. We see on the torus that there are two color changes. The first takes place at the location of the pinch. This is where the reversal of the cylinder section is located. We can open the shape to observe what is happening in it. There is a continuity of colors when the surfaces seem to intersect. The second color change occurs where the cylinder has been closed on itself. And this change does not correspond to anything for this surface. There is no reason to change the color at this location. The color can be extended beyond this artificial boundary and, as with the Möbius ribbon, the whole surface is painted in a single color. There is only one side. The Möbius ribbon is also a surface with one side. What is the difference with the Klein torus? The difference is that the Möbius ribbon has one edge, only one, but it has an edge. The Klein torus doesn't have any edge. The sphere, for example, is an example of a surface with no edge, but it has two sides, one interior and one exterior. And since we can paint a Klein torus with only one color, it doesn't have an interior and an exterior. We all are inside a Klein bottle, a Klein torus, or outside the Klein bottle. Let's open our Klein torus again to examine its interior. We have a Klein half torus. Let's remove the twist to see what happens. We obtain the kind of a wheel rim, a 3D half torus. Let's twist again half a turn to recover our Klein half torus. Let's us now unfold the loop of this half torus. Half of a pinshot cylinder is obtained. Now we can change our 4D camera to flatten the vertical dimension, and we get a Möbius ribbon. And this time, since there is only half a cylinder, there is only one layer, and we no longer see a color change at the center. It's a Möbius ribbon before closing the loop. But when it is closed on itself, it doesn't give the usual shape. Why? Because this ribbon is folded into the fourth dimension. The loop is not formed in 3D space like the classic ribbon we are used to. A Klein torus is made of two half torus. Each half torus is a Möbius ribbon closed in 4D. Let's take the time to observe how the two ribbons bend and come together to form a Klein torus. In the first version of my script, I stopped roughly here. But I know that 4D is not easy to imagine. So I propose to continue a little bit to understand the close relationship between a Möbius ribbon and a Klein torus. Let's start with a flat ribbon. We have two dimensions, width and length. To form a Möbius ribbon, we must twist the width and loop the length. Each of these operations must be done in a plane that cannot be the horizontal plane. So we need an extra dimension to twist the width and an extra dimension to loop the length. In a 3D space, we have only one additional dimension and, necessarily, we use it both for the twist and the loop. But if our ribbon is immersed in 4D space, we have two additional dimensions at our disposal and we can choose one for the twist and the other one for the loop. We will represent the two additional dimensions by two different colors. We display on the screen how each dimension is visible according to the rotation of the 4D camera. Let's start by twisting using the blue dimension. We get a standard twisted tape. By turning the 4D camera, the blue dimension gradually disappears in favor of the more and more visible red dimension. When the blue dimension has completely disappeared, the ribbon is flat, with a pinch in the middle, corresponding to where the width of the ribbon is perfectly aligned with the blue dimension, which is here totally crushed. Let's go back to the flat ribbon and perform the loop of the length using this time the red dimension. Since this dimension is not visible, it looks like the ribbon is shrinking. But turning the 4D camera, we see that the flat ribbon reappears. We can now combine the twist and the loop to obtain a Möbius ribbon using the four dimensions at our disposal. By changing the angle of the 4D camera, we recover the appearance of a classic 3D Möbius ribbon, even if it is indeed a surface immersed in a 4D space. To form a Klein torus, we can start from a flat ribbon that we bend into half a cylinder. Then, just take another ribbon that is bent in the opposite direction. By twisting and looping these two ribbons, one should obtain a Klein torus. This cylinder can also be formed with a single ribbon that is completely closed on its width. But let's keep two ribbons to better track the deformations. However, there is still a small question. When bending our ribbon, we used one of the two extra dimensions. We must decide now whether it is the dimension of the twist or the dimension of the loop. Let's try it with the dimension of the twist. The cylinder twists in the direction of its length. By closing it on itself, we get a Clifford torus. That's not what we want. Now, let's use the direction of the loop. By twisting and closing the two curved ribbon, we find the Klein torus. A Klein torus is the merging of two 4D Möbius ribbons. It's also a single 4D Möbius ribbon whose single edge is closed on itself. Let's observe once again the formation of a Klein torus from a single flat strip plunged in 4D. We still have a big question. Is really the Klein torus the same thing as the Klein bottle? The two shapes look quite different now. To form a Klein torus, we need to glue the front circle of the cylinder onto the rear circle, but with a U-turn before gluing the two. To achieve our goal, we made the U-turn using the fourth dimension and we passed the cylinder from the outside. To form his bottle, Klein operates differently. He simply turns around at the front of the cylinder. Note that it remains in 3D space. From there, his idea was to stick the front of the cylinder through the inside. But for that, it would have to pass through the wall of the cylinder. He can't do it. So he bypasses this obstacle by jumping through the fourth dimension. He can then glue the two ends together. Finally, and also it's not necessary, it widens the base of the cylinder. And it's true that it's prettier. You can do the same thing to build the Möbius ribbon. You can extend the front to make it turn around. To stick it to the other extremity, we jump through the third dimension. The figure obtained is a Möbius ribbon. Indeed, if we unfold where the ends are sticked, we recover the shape we are used to. By moving the 4D camera around the Klein's bottle, we end up seeing the part of the neck of the bottle that goes through the fourth dimension to go around the walls and join the cap. As with the ribbon, we can unfold the 4D fold at the base of the bottle bottom and recover the known shape of the Klein torus. The neck seems to pass through the wall of the bottle, but with the changes in perspective related to the movements of the 4D camera, the crossing of the walls changes places. This is an illusion due to our projection and not a real crossing. Before we finish, let's have fun getting inside Klein's bottle. We enter from below through the base of the bottle. The tunnel is narrowing. We are in the bottleneck. The passage is clogged. It is the crossing with the wall. But it's an illusion. Just change the position of the camera and the passage is free. We climb to go to the top of the neck of the bottle. We dive back down. The neck opens. And we discover the inside of the bottle where we can see the passage we took to come here. I hope you enjoyed this travel in 4D and that you learned some interesting things on the Klein bottle. This is my English channel and I have more videos in my French channel. I will try from now on to translate more of my videos to feed this channel. So stay tuned. See you soon. Si elle se déchire pas, il y a un endroit... Putain, c'est chiant.